belief cannot contain certainty, because what belief is uncertainty. That's what it is. You cannot have both certainty and uncertainty together. It's impossible. You have to choose one or the other. But certainty remains certain, even though you may choose uncertainty and try to affiliate yourself with it. So we cannot bring certainty to uncertainty within the kingdom of uncertainty. What existence is the kingdom of uncertainty. But it's more than a kingdom. It is an attempt to develop a way to destroy certainty. So as we're all believing, we're dwelling in this kingdom of belief, there's purposeful activity. There's a purpose to it all, which is to develop through process some way to develop a way to destroy reality, threaten reality, to threaten certainty. And there's no way to be happy within that context at all, because certainty is happiness. That's what happiness is. Reality is certain of itself. There's no uncertainty there whatsoever. So it is the hallmark of a reality is certainty. All-inclusiveness, certain of this, certain of everything that it is. Isness is certain of isness. Effortless certainty. What is happening right now in the kingdom of uncertainty, kingdom of belief, is an all-out war trying to stamp out all of the different ways that certainty is witnessed to in this world, that we're reminded of certainty. Everything that we would be, all the attractions to certainty that we have in this world, which is various teachings and teachers and inquiry and efforts to gravitate towards certainty. It's trying to wipe all those out. There's an intense war going on. There has been for quite some time. And you might call it spiritual warfare. But certainty is not at war with anything. It's certain, already certain of itself. It's uncertainty that is declared a jihad on certainty. It's uncertainty that is desperately trying to get rid of any witnesses to certainty, any teachings that help us gravitate towards certainty, any institutions that help us, anything at all. And it's relentless in this quest. And it is definitely getting there to the point where certainty may have to back away, or that what happens is belief backs away from certainty. You know, when you lose your attraction to certainty, or you submerge it and feel that it's an extreme threat, you will then back away from certainty. So it's not like certainty leaves or backs away. It's that the kingdom of belief backs away from certainty. And again, certainty cannot bring certainty to belief. It's impossible. It's like you cannot have light and darkness in the same place. You cannot have certainty and uncertainty together. It's not possible. But you cannot have the kingdom of certainty and have certainty in its, you know, there in its fullness. It's not possible. We can have teachings that say, hey, it's okay to be attracted towards certainty. We can have ambassadors of certainty, et cetera, et cetera. But we cannot have certainty within the context of uncertainty, within the context of belief. Belief is uncertainty. That's what it is. It's not knowing. It's believing. So we call it belief, not knowing. So the kingdom of belief is trying to re-energize and re-engage itself so that it can back away from the attraction of certainty. And it is doing this. It is doing this to an alarming extent, to an amazing extent. Everyone here that is trying to be attracted to certainty, they're being blackmailed. They're being all sorts of ways to criminalize this. it's essentially being criminalized. And if it hasn't, and there's additional layers to that, that anybody who is attracted to certainty will be targeted and set up for blackmail and control that way. It's exactly what's happened in this world. So it's very rare that you have uncompromised teaching, an attraction to certainty, very strong attraction to certainty. Belief is constantly trying to compromise such conduits and find ways to enmesh them in legal troubles. Look at the disciples of Jesus, how they were, the apostles, how they were constantly hounded and attempts to crucify them and put them to death. That's exactly what belief does. Because belief believes that it is reality and that certainty is trying to annihilate reality. In other words, it completely has things backwards, upside down and backwards. It's belief that's trying to annihilate reality, but belief insists that it's reality trying to annihilate belief. So it believes it's justified in trying to annihilate any conduits of certainty in this world that are attracting others back to certainty. And it's in this world there have been various certainty has set up various legal systems, various situations that set aside certainty that's not under the legal jurisdiction of belief, not so much. So it can't be blackmailed. You know, false accusations cannot be raised against those. What has happened is that has all collapsed, and the legal situation in the world is now encourages false accusations to be brought against those who are attracting towards certainty. And basically, there's no defense anymore in this world. Previously, you had the sangha, or the religious institutions, which had a different legal system, a separate legal system from the civil legal system. That was necessary to protect from false accusations. Now, it's not perfect, of course. There troubles arise, but in other words, the adjudication of any situation for a religious, someone's in a religious order, a sangha, a member of any renunciate order, who's dedicated to inquiry, satsang, and being attracted to certainty, they had their own legal system, and they would be, the situation would be adjudicated by that system, which protected from false allegations, blackmail, false allegations, and all of that, which is what belief tenders in. That is how belief operates, is through wickedness. And it will do anything to bring down any conduits of certainty, any attraction to certainty. It will make any lie, any false accusation, any blackmail, whatever it has to do, because it literally believes that certainty is trying to annihilate uncertainty, belief. That's like darkness claiming that light is trying to annihilate darkness. But the truth is, it's darkness that's trying to annihilate light. And light is simply saying that it's a futile quest. Certainty is simply saying it's a futile quest to try and threaten reality. That's all. But belief does not take it that way at all. So that is why there were separate legal systems that protected those attracted to certainty from the wicked machinations and false accusations of those who were dedicated to belief and uncertainty and this effort to try and threaten reality. Right now, that is broken down. That belief has been working to break that down as much as possible, to try to make everyone who is attracting to certainty vulnerable to all sorts of false accusations and blackmail and imprisonment and all of that, legal suits, all those things. And what that does is it terrorizes those who are conduits of certainty to shut up, you know, to stop trying to attract to certainty. It absolutely does. So it's a ruinous situation in the world right now. And of course, those who are loyal to belief and uncertainty in the effort to threaten reality, they see this as tremendous progress. They say, my gosh, finally we're making this progress. We're in an age of enlightenment. We're going towards a golden age where everyone is equal under the law. They keep saying this type of thing. What they're really saying is that that there will be no protection for anyone who tries to witness to certainty and attract to certainty. And they see that as a golden age where belief is not threatened by certainty. So that belief can go 100% towards its objective of threatening, finding a way to threaten and reality, force the prime creator to change reality and make spirit prime creator. So we're not going towards a golden age. We're going to an incredibly dark age. Because in this world, within belief, there has to be ways to encourage people to be attracted towards certainty and give them protections from false accusations and all sorts of setups and blackmail. And, in the kingdom of belief, the word of one who's dedicated to belief is taken as true, and the word of those who are attracted to certainty is taken as false. So anyone can make a false accusation. And in the kingdom of belief, the courts, the legal system, will believe the one who is loyal to belief. You know, when you have a he said, she said situation, the verdict will go to the one who believes in belief and against the one who is loyal to certainty. That's how it works. And that's why separate legal systems were set up to protect against this. Otherwise, how can people make progress? How can we make progress? How can we allow ourselves to be attracted to certainty when to do so is essentially ensuring our persecution and enslavement and imprisonment? And what happens is that belief is an enslavement system. Everybody's under fear, and those who are most loyal to belief enslave those who are less loyal to belief and threaten them with, if they don't do the drudgery and the slave work, that they are going to be imprisoned. It's a slave system. It absolutely is. And the more loyal one is to belief, the higher one rises up in the system and has others under them that they control and under threat of, you know, like on a plantation slave system, if the slave owners say that this slave threatened me or something, then off with their head, you know, just like that. There's no recourse. Slaves don't have any real recourse under the law. And we're in a tacitly slave system already in this world where we don't really have, there's not equal protection under law at all. Because belief hates facts, because reality is a fact and it's trying to destroy reality. So belief does not respect facts at all. It basically wants to go simply on someone's an accusation and then believing in the accuser because the accuser is loyal to belief. That is where we're headed right now. And the whole legal system has been breaking down severely for a long time now. For a long time, it's been a relentless assault on the legal system. The legal system in the United States, for instance, was set up to try and give equal protection, to try and say you must have facts, you must have proof, etc. That's been under relentless assault, and ideologically, it's not supported anymore. It's not supported. It is, you know, those who are loyal to belief can get away with anything, and those who are not loyal to belief will be falsely accused of anything. So, of course, people tend to gravitate to be safe from the legal, the jaws of this legal monster we have, to gravitate towards being loyal to belief and rejecting truth, rejecting certainty, and saying that certainty is a deceiver that it wants to annihilate belief, etc., etc. Well, that's the system. That is the system that we're in right now. It's getting worse by the day. The underpinnings are all there. The ideology is there, and it's intense. It's already intense. It's going to become a lot more intense very soon. So I don't know what protection is available. That is the question I've been asking my whole life. You know, how do you function here in this world if you're attracting others towards certainty? You are absolutely under the most incredible siege here. How does one protect oneself? One of the ways is sometimes the truth comes in the form of a female now, and it's hard for females to accuse females. You see, that's, they still haven't worked that out yet. Where it's very easy now for a female to accuse a male of anything, any false accusation, and she's going to be, the female will be believed, and the male will not be believed. Because most of the institutions and renunciate orders are male, and a lot of the attraction towards certainty has been male throughout history. So it's very important for belief to put males in a position where they can be falsely accused. So sometimes the ambassadors of truth will come in now as female form, and it's harder to accuse them. Let's see, it's harder to accuse them. But they're working on that too. They're working on that too. They're getting to that too. There will be a splitting of those females who are super loyal to belief and those who are not, and the females will be accused also. They're getting to that. It's just right now, it's the males that have no standing, have no legal standing whatsoever in this world right now. Men do not have any legal standing. That is a fact. In the past, they had some protection against false accusation. Now they don't have really any protection. A woman can bruise her arm herself, inflict any sort of bruise, and then claim that the man did it, and it'll be a he said, she said thing, and benefit of the doubt will go to the female, false accusation, and then the male will be thrown in jail, lose their job, etc. Or the female can use that and say, look, I'm going to go to the authorities if you don't cease and desist from your attraction to certainty. And then the male will be so terrified of losing his reputation, losing his job, losing his standing, you know, in the community, everything, that he'll say, okay, I'm going to drop my attraction to certainty. Exactly what's taking place all over the planet is that this, the belief is, has a way to threaten those who are attracted to certainty and threaten them with the most severe reprisals, and it'll get worse and worse and worse. That's why we say it's the end of times. The cycle of extreme wickedness is here in the world. Jesus said that at the end of the cycle, even those most attracted to certainty will fall away from it. Why? Because we're under such extreme threat. Extreme threat. The question is, how there must be some way to be protected from this threat, some Passover principle. And we need to explore that. And also just because you happen to be female in this world doesn't mean you're not under threat also, because you will be targeted next. Those females who attracted to certainty will be targeted next. See, originally the belief told females that by targeting males, by pulling away the legal protection males had from false accusations, that they would be rise up in society and have all this power and control. But what weren't told is that later on, those females who attracted certainty, which are many, they're going to be targeted too. That's going to be their protection from false accusation will be pulled away too. And there were certainly some wise females in this world, many, who realized that and said, whoa, 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 whoa. This whole thing is going to end up unraveling. Let's not do this. Let's keep the protection of men. Let's keep a legal protection in place. So that false accusation is a very, very difficult thing to prosecute. But they were, belief just, you know, pushed them aside and kept throwing inducements their way, and it's eroded, that will has eroded. So belief ends up devouring itself, because we're all attracted to certainty. And so belief, wherever belief looks, it sees, there's an attraction to certainty. It just goes after the worst examples first. And then it goes after the last verse and the last verse, and it just doesn't stop. It doesn't stop. Because we all have certainty within us. We all have certainty within us. So it may very well be that people will be ascended off this planet or go somewhere. I don't know. That's possible, because the legal structure here is so wicked right now and getting worse, you know, exponentially. that is not really feasible to be a strong attractor towards certainty, and it's better to regroup in a way. I'm not sure how it's going to play out. I don't have the information there. I'm trying to get that information. How can you really be protected in a world where anyone, if they don't like you, don't like your attraction of certainty, can bring a false accusation? And in fact, people in this world have been brought up now, skilled to make false accusations. They've been trained to do it. They've been trained in the whole way, system that belief has brought in, how to use it. And that is what is going to happen very soon. It is the will to stand up against this massive assault by belief against attraction to certainty. See, certainty itself cannot be assaulted, but the attraction to certainty can be assaulted. Attraction means we're not sure, we're not yet abiding in certainty. Abiding in certainty, there's no need to even talk about attraction. Attraction implies a distancing, right? You're attracted to something. So our attraction to certainty means that we're still trying to do both belief and certainty, but we're gravitating towards certainty. That can be attacked. That absolutely can be attacked because we still are holding on to belief, and belief can attack itself. Absolutely can and does attack itself. So the situation in the world is dire. It is incredibly dire right now because of the training that has been undertaken now in this world. Younger generations have grown up in this massive assault atmosphere of assault upon, safeguards against false accusation in this world. And I guess evidence can be manufactured, evidence can be planted. There's all sorts of ways, and this has been done throughout history, which is why the saints and the sages, etc., have often been persecuted to an extreme extent in this world. That's what belief does. But now we can out belief. We can see what belief is doing. We can out belief. And by outing belief, we can put ourselves in a position to be insulated from it. Really has to be insulated. The agitation that is coming, the agitprop, all this stuff, the world's already been propagandized. And it's already in the major institutions of the world have already accepted into their very bones this whole culture of belief, of attack against attraction to certainty, and the whole acceptance of false accusations. In any corporation, any institution in the world, every single man in that corporation is completely vulnerable to false accusations because they can always be claimed, oh, there was no witnesses, but it's just a he said, she said thing, and the damage of that corporation, just to have that raised into the media, puffs it up like something, the PR damage is enormous. So any sort of accusation is immediately said, what do we need to do to make this accusation go away? And then they will be told, well, you need to step down, or you need to adopt these new laws, these new workplace restrictions, these et cetera, et cetera. And they will do it. They will do anything because they're terrified of bad PR. That's been going on for a long time. And it's now part of the very fabric of this world right now, that men really don't have any protection at all from false accusations, and therefore, whatever positions of power they have, they're simply puppets. They're simply carrying out what belief wants them to carry out. That's it. And of course, many men don't need the threat to do that, but those who would use the institutions of this world to help us gravitate towards certainty are being ferreted out and being driven out of all positions of power in this world, in the media, in politics, in business, in religion, in every last institution in this world. Anyone, it's basically men, since they're the ones who had these positions, if they don't if they don't give compelling, strong, convincing evidence that they're loyal to belief and have disavowed loyalty to attraction to certainty, they are being driven out and have already been driven out through threats. And they can't even, there's no way they can climb up into positions of power anymore at all. It's not possible because you have all these gatekeepers there who very carefully vet anyone who comes in to those situations to make certain that they're loyal to belief and the agenda of belief. And anybody who backslides, false accusation will be raised up. And there's many, and there's also, there's another layer to it too, where those people who are targeted are encouraged to engage in behavior that might be actionable. And they're saying, oh, this is all consensual, and that's what we want, that's what we want. And then later, they say, oh no, that was not consensual, or no, I did not encourage that at all. And then that's threatened with blackmail that way, that if you don't do what we want you to do, you know, and this is something that's been going on throughout history. This is not new at all. This is exactly what's taken place throughout history. Why those who are attracted to, gravitating towards certainty have tried to protect themselves from this sort of wickedness. And very unfortunate that it has gained the upper hand at this time in the world, and it has severely gained the upper hand to the point where you have to admit that the notion that there is going to be an exodus of some sort from this planet or something like that seems to make sense, seems to fit. And belief will implode. Because it is determined to, you know, ferret out any attraction to certainty. And we all have attraction to certainty. That's our deepest love. And what belief wants us is to forsake that deepest love and put that love onto belief. Which is why belief uses bodies and tries to put up beautiful bodies and have them worshiped and wants us to love these, you know, goddesses, so to speak, or gods or goddesses. And forsake the love we have for certainty. So you'll have these queen bees, these beautiful queen bees with their power enclaves, their nests, and people will be, you know, it's back to matriarchy and goddess worship is that's how belief works. It sets up all these temples. You have the goddesses in these temples. You go worship the goddess, you know, and you're bowing to belief. You're trying to say, I love uncertainty. I love belief. I'm disavowing my attraction to certainty. That's the religion of belief, and it is hell-bent on setting that up again, and it will do that. That is what it is. That is its aim, and there's nothing in this way right now, really. This coming election is pretty much the tipping point about that. We'll see how it goes, but even so, it's gone too far right now to pull back, you know. It jumped over the abyss already without a parachute. Again, belief is trying to get us to reject our love for certainty. And it knows it can't get rid of this love we have. So it tries to get us to transfer this love from certainty onto uncertainty. It tries to make uncertainty very beautiful, very glamorous, very sexy. That's what it tries to do. It tries to get us, it tries to use the attraction, sexual attraction, calls that love and tries to get us to make that primary. Okay, and then believing that this is somehow pulling us away from our love for certainty. And so you see that, like, the females in the world are dressing super provocatively and sexy in public. You know, it's just unbelievable. Sometimes you go out and just say, what in the world is going on? Whereas in a society that's attracted towards certainty, what you try to do is you minimize the sexual attraction and attractiveness. You try to minimize it. So you're not getting confused about, wait a minute, you know, what is love? You know, our love is for certainty. It's not for the flesh at all. That is just a sensory stimulation. There's no love in that at all. And so belief tries to elevate the love of the flesh and tell us that's our true love. And this love for certainty is a fake, false love. It tries to, see, that's, and you can just think about history and see. This is exactly what's taking place. And we're so, And those who are going towards reestablishment of goddess worship and the matriarchy, you know, and love of uncertainty and love of sensuality and attraction to the flesh and all that, they think they're making great progress. This is enlightenment, and that this is the hope for great progress that had been held back all these years. In other words, they got it completely backwards, as you would expect. And yet the world has been absolutely overrun by these loyalists to belief, completely overrun by it. And so, like, you see the immodesty. The immodesty among females is a certain sign of the decay back into worshiping of belief and trying to disavow love of certainty, love of reality. It's a certain sign. In a civilization that is dedicated towards moving towards gravitating towards certainty, female modesty is another, is a certain sign, absolute certain sign. And there's laws that protect against false accusations, very strong laws. And so that enables the situation to gravitate towards certainty and recognize your true love, your true love. Your true love is not the flesh. Your true love is not belief. Absolutely not. In fact, you're disgusted with it. Absolutely disgusted with it. You have no love for it whatsoever. It's just a stimulus response thing of the flesh. That's it. So you can never free yourself from your love of certainty. It's impossible. And yet belief believes it can free you. So just imagine what belief is going to put you through. As it continually believes it can free you, it's going to just torture the heck out of you and bring every kind of affliction possible and torment you and terrify you and frighten you and imprison you, all those things. Because it the more you encourage belief, the more wicked it becomes. The more you give belief encouragement that yeah, I am disavowing my attraction to certainty, the more that encourages the belief to believe that, yeah, it can do it all the way and to use even more extreme measures against you, thinking that it's almost succeeded, therefore it just whips you a little harder, it's going to succeed. Look at the way that Jesus, the passion story unfolded, which was ambassador of certainty in this world, who would not disavow his love for certainty at all, and the torture that they put him through, you know, and ultimately crucifixion, was to try and get him to disavow his love for certainty, which he did not do. Did not do that. Which is showing us that we cannot disavow it. That's the purpose of it. Showing us that we literally cannot disavow it. Cannot. It's impossible. Okay? Because if it was possible, he would have disavowed it. Did not disavow it. Did not. So, knowing that it's impossible to disavow it, why even go down that road of encouraging belief that it can be disavowed? Because the more encouragement you give belief, the wickeder it becomes. And this world is flooded with those now who believe that, you know, they can disavow their love of certainty and get free of it entirely. And so they'll just, what you do is you'll just revel in the flesh and hedonism and sensuality in barbaric torture. I mean, look at like Roman Empire. I mean, it was so utterly wallowing in its sensuality and brutality, so extremely brutal, unbelievably. Well, we're headed right back there. And the legal systems are crumbling right now. Step by step, they're absolutely crumbling. The safeguards are crumbling. And of course, those who are attracted to certainty are very aware of this, because they're the ones who are targeted by this. So of course they're aware. And those who are loyal to belief are celebrating and saying, hey, things are becoming better and better and better. And like, shake your pom-poms and just say, cheerleading and say, this is great. Finally, you know, we're getting what we want. They're getting what they want, but they're not getting what they really want. That is a fact. And so this type of talk here has to be done now, because otherwise it'll be too late. Very soon it'll be too late. And we have to prepare for some sort of insulation from this situation and to realize you cannot bring certainty to uncertainty. It's impossible. You cannot bring certainty to belief. And that belief insists that if anything be done, that must be done. And it cannot be done. So those who insist upon that have to back away from certainty. You cannot hold on to that. They want to back away. They'll back away. And you cannot, don't chase after them, because you cannot bring certainty to uncertainty. And they will feel that they're being attacked. and then they'll accuse you of attacking. And in order to then get on their good side so you can help them, supposedly help them, you have to stop attacking them from their standpoint. In other words, stop attracting them to certainty. Stop trying to bring certainty. So really, the spiritual path has to come from within, where someone is, it just says, you know, this attraction to certainty, this is what I really love, and I'm going to follow that true love and disavow, you know, start disavowing the love of the flesh, the love of existence, the love of matter and form and all this kind of stuff. Uncertainty, belief, start disengaging from that and re-engage with love for certainty, which has always been there. It has to come from within. It cannot be imposed from without. It cannot be imposed. Certainty cannot impose itself on uncertainty. But belief believes it can. It insists that it can. Because belief, to believe everything is possible. There's no such thing as facts. Therein lies the insanity of belief, which is why it has to come. There has to be a turning within of like, okay, what do I truly love? You know, do I love the flesh, or do I love certainty? Do I love belief, or do I love certainty? What do I truly love? Of course, what do I want? Difference between what do I want and what do I really want? What do I think I love and what do I really love? What do I believe I love and what do I really love? Can't have both. You can't please both. You can't please both. Okay. Because the flesh will insist that you disavow your love of certainty. Belief will insist upon that, because it says that that's attacking belief, and it's it cannot love attack, you know, cannot love that attack, and so you won't be lovable if you have a love of certainty. You won't be lovable to belief. You can't have both. Jesus said you cannot serve two masters equally well. If you try to, you'll be disloyal to both. That's what is being said. You either are loyal to belief, or are you loyal to certainty? And of course, what we're doing is gravitating towards that, disengaging from belief and re-engaging to certainty. But how it will play out in the future is something we're going to find out, and we have to hang in there. But I woke up this morning, my gosh, just with this intense realization, you know, of the threat that a false accusation is just, it's been with me my entire life. My entire life I've been under this terrible threat of false accusation. And then what the false accusers, what they do is they say, oh, well, if you don't want the accusation to be false, then why don't you commit the crime and then it'll be a true accusation? And that's their, what they think is fairness. You know, but the issue is the attempt to disavow your love of certainty. That is the issue. That is at stake. And again, they believe if you don't do that, you're trying to annihilate them. So they feel justified. And they think of being fair, let's make it a true accusation. So at least we don't feel bad about, you know, trying to separate you from your love of certainty. Amazingly wicked place, this world, really. And I know those who are loyal to belief will poo-poo this and think, you know, it's the stupidest thing they've ever heard. But if you go back through history, you realize this is the testimony of every one who's been on the spiritual path throughout history, as they have come up upon this, and they have, you know, suffered under it, and they have been very aware of this. It's just right now, you know, saying these things is like a death sentence, you know, because the situation is tilting so extremely now back to the religion of belief, the religion of uncertainty, where the attempt to separate from our love of certainty, trying to disavow that entirely, trying to transfer that love onto uncertainty, onto the flesh, and all that entails. That is just a roaring avalanche right now in the world. So I'm trying to warn those who are gravitating towards certainty that some situation of protection and insulation may arise. It should arise. We deserve it. Now, there is the Passover principle, but belief will flee from us, but that fleeing, they will make it seem as if we are attacking. They're fleeing because we're attacking them. And so we may try to follow up and say, no, we're not attacking you. I'm going to try to chase after him. And in doing that, we will get enmeshed in the whole false accusation and pogroms, incarceration, re-education, all the stuff that's coming. We'll get trapped into it because we, out of our compassion and you know, the very fact that they say that, well, certainty is attacking uncertainty, that itself is a false accusation. That's the mother of all false accusations. So what we're doing here is we're recognizing that. We're bringing that out of the closet and saying, that's the mother of all false accusations, is that certainty is attacking uncertainty. And if we don't see that, we will get sucked into the game of uncertainty, the game of belief, and we will think that we're the bad guys, and we need to correction, which then we will then put ourselves under threat of false accusation, imprisonment, torture, all of that, in order to try and modify our love of certainty so it doesn't feel like it's attacking, you know, belief. And then we're caught. That is how we get caught and ensnared. Certainty is not attacking uncertainty. It's uncertainty. It's belief that's attacking, trying to attack certainty. It's a one-way attack. Reality cannot be attacked. So it's a one-way attack. So it's, we spirit have to realize that it's belief that is attack, trying to attack reality, trying to develop a way to attack reality. So we have to disavow belief and say, this is a futile quest. It's a waste of time. It's spirit that has to disavow it. Belief will never disavow itself. Cannot, it's impossible, cannot. It will always believe that certainty is trying to attack it, always. So you cannot wait for belief to admit to its wickedness, to its insanity. It cannot, it will never do so. So spiritually, we have to take a stand spiritually, as spirit, and say, this is the way things are, this is truth. It's belief that's insane, it's belief is trying to attack reality, trying to attack certainty. And we are deciding we don't want that anymore. We don't want that scenario anymore. And it's belief that's trying to distance itself, is distancing itself from certainty. It's belief that is fleeing the attraction to certainty. And don't go chase after it. It's a very difficult thing to do. It can be a very difficult thing to do because you'll feel like you're the bad one. You're the bad one. You're driving them away. You've done something to frighten them. No, they're frightening themselves because their desire to attack certainty and the inability to do so is frightening them. It's frightening them. They feel threatened. They feel certainty is going to annihilate them. So they flee because of this insane notion that of belief. And they're the ones who have to find it within themselves to turn this around within themselves. And sometimes you just have to let them flee. Let them go. And in the fleeing, they take their baggage with them, right? What is the baggage? This world, you know? They take that with them. So those who are attracted to certainty, they really have their own paradise, their own realm right now, but the world is like superimposed upon it, as they're trying to help here. But as the world flees, you know, it will become aware of this divine domain. Something like that. But the world is definitely getting ready to flee from certainty in mass and take all, you know, all the luggage with them, all their possessions, as it were. That's the real exodus, you know, the flight from truth, the flight from certainty, the flight from what we really love. All of that, the world is now preparing a massive exodus from that. And again, don't follow that. Let it go. And again, the struggle is this: we'll think we're the bad ones, that we should be able to, you know, somehow be effective with certainty here. But again, if it's not coming from within them, and it's something external only, they will feel like a threat. They'll feel threatened because they don't realize what's going on, what belief is, where it came from. that its belief is trying to find a way to destroy reality or threaten reality with destruction. So this can force the Prime Creator to change reality and make Spirit Prime Creator. Belief doesn't know this. It doesn't know. It doesn't know. It's only Spirit knows. But if we don't listen to Spirit, our inner Spirit, our inner knowing, we won't know this. If we don't listen to knowing, we won't know that. We won't know what is knowable. We'll only believe, and belief can only see it from the standpoint of belief, and from the standpoint of belief, it's certainty that is trying to attack belief. And therefore, those who reject knowing will feel that threatened by certainty, and will flee from it. So the fleeing may be sequential, you know. As belief flees from certainty, certainty may find itself in better and better and better situations, less and less baggage of the world. It just has to allow for that, you know. It's not certainty that it's at fault. But again, there are limits to what certainty can do vis-a-vis belief, because it cannot impose itself upon belief. It's impossible. It can only attract what is within each of us. The attraction, the love of certainty, can only attract that and encourage the gravitation towards that. It cannot impose it from externally, from belief. It's impossible. And if the world demands that's the only way it can be done, then the world is fleeing. So again, those who are loyal to certainty, who are attracted to certainty, gravitating that way, may find themselves, I would say they will, soon, in very, very benefits, wonderful circumstances. And they just have to accept it. Because as belief flees, what does it leave behind? Certainty. It leaves behind certainty. It leaves behind the attraction to certainty. It leaves behind everything that is affiliated with certainty. It only takes that which is uncertain, and leaves behind, you know, the jewels. I mean, the real jewels. What is really strongly of value. And those who are attracted to gravitating towards certainty, they'll find themselves with that in highly, highly beneficial situations. But then they cannot leave those situations and chase after those who are fleeing. You know, cannot do that. Then they will find themselves in re-education camps, is what they'll find. At best, you know, that would be, and they think, oh, you know, I can do a lot of good here. No. Anyone who has a strong attraction to certainty will be an absolute pariah in what is to come in this world. And at the very best, they'll be going to undergo severe re-education. And then from there, they'll have much, much worse stuff going on. The belief is attempting to eradicate any gravitation towards certainty. And it has the capability to do that, to eradicate it, pull it up from the roots, to completely remove it. And that's its goal, that's its purpose. And it will most certainly try to accomplish that purpose, as it has done in the past many times, but now it has even more means at its disposal. So let uncertainty flee for now. I mean, it's just a cycle. The love of certainty remains within everyone, and it will reassert itself at some point. Guaranteed. It can never lose the love of certainty is within us. On the surface, it may seem as everyone's jumping through hoops and putting on this big song and dance about disavowing their love of certainty. It may seem as though they're getting rid of their love of certainty, but they're not. They're not. It's just a big smoke and mirrors type of thing. But when we see that big smoke and mirrors thing, we may get so worried, like, oh my gosh, they might be able to get separate from their love of certainty, and that means I could too. I better go in and help them. Or you might feel so much compassion, you might want to jump into the fire and help them, you know. Now, they're not losing anything. They're just believing they're losing, but they're not. And quickly the love of certainty reasserts itself. It will arise again like a phoenix from the ashes. It's impossible to eradicate. But there are those who really want to try to eradicate it, so just let them do it. Let them do it. No harm. No harm to reality, no harm to certainty. It's just a delaying tactic. Just a delaying tactic. And the love of certainty will reassert, and then they will decide, hey, you know, that eradication never didn't work. Let's, enough of that. Let's get the attraction to certainty. Let's fan those flames. Let's gravitate towards that. And then they will. They will. The danger is not to them. The danger is those who are strongly gravitating towards certainty to jump into that fire or to get freaked out by all the smoke and mirrors, the big song and dance that's going to take place of thinking like, hey, maybe it's possible, you know, to separate that love. Or they may feel themselves losing that gravitation, that love towards certainty, like start gravitating back towards uncertainty, you know, out of compassion or something. That is a real danger that it'll undermine your own attraction towards certainty these times. Definitely can. So I just have to let the fleeing happen. Let the fleeing happen. It's not you that are fleeing. It's uncertainty that is fleeing. Fleeing from certainty. That's a separation of the wheat and the chaff. Right now, the sheep from the goats, as it were. That's exactly what's happening right now. He let that happen. And then they'll go through another cycle where they need to gravitate towards certainty during that cycle. That's all that happens. No one is ever lost. It's impossible. Because reality is all-inclusive from the very beginning, so we are all perfectly included in reality. It can never be changed. We can deny that. We can fight against it. We can believe against it, but that's all we can do is just believe against it. We cannot make that a fact, make it true. So there's a real purpose to these videos. It is those who are attracted towards, you know, the love of certainty, which is reality, are the ones who are potentially in danger of getting real shaky and wobbly about that and you know, being sucked into this vortex, really, because being in harm's way as far as they may end up, you know, trying to disavow their love of certainty. Like Jesus said to Peter, he said, you know, Peter was making all these avowals of love of certainty. Love of Jesus means love of certainty. And Jesus said, look, before the rooster crows three times in the morning, next morning, you will disavow me three times. Or was it before the rooster crows at all or one time, whatever. You'll disavow me three times. And Peter said, there's no way, impossible. What are you talking about? How could you possibly doubt my attraction to certainty? Jesus says, you'll find out. And then that's exactly what happened, is because they seized Peter and said, there's one of them. There's someone who loves certainty. Let's stone him. Let's kill him. And Peter says, no. I don't know anyone named Jesus. I have no, you're mistaking me for somebody else. And they said, oh, yeah. And then someone else recognized them in the same song and dance. And no. It's not me. I don't even know. Never heard of him. I have no affiliation whatsoever. Complete disavowal of the love of certainty. So that is, you know, Jesus pointing out that is true. That is what happens here. Is under threat of being stoned to death, you know, we will disavow our love of certainty. That's the dynamic here. Is the, you know, this effort now to seize anyone who has any love of certainty here as, you know, quote unquote enemies of the state, enemies of diversity, enemies of the world, enemies of progress, enemies of freedom, enemies, whatever, because they belief believes that certainty is trying to annihilate belief. So, you know, it's the ultimate enemy, however you want to say it. Belief believes that certainty is an absolute ruthless killer that is out to annihilate belief. And thereby annihilating belief, annihilating us, because belief believes we're its children. We're children of belief. So belief believes it's protecting us all from this annihilation by certainty, which is completely insane. But again, belief will never understand that it's completely insane. It's impossible for belief to know that. Belief cannot know. Only facts are known. Facts are inherently known. They're true and they're known. And belief cannot know anything. It can only believe. And so it's a fact that certainty is not trying to destroy uncertainty. Certainly, certainty just is. And uncertainty is nothing. It's belief that's trying to destroy certainty. And belief will never be able to know this, because knowing means as a fact, there's no belief involved. It's a directly known. No belief involved at all. So how can belief know? It cannot. So it's an extremely bad guide. Belief is a terrible guide for anyone. It inherently leads you away from your love and attraction to certainty. It inherently does so. Because it believes that that attraction is really being attracted to your own annihilation and the annihilation of all everyone else. So it thinks that you're a protector. That's how mad this existence really is. If you can see the madness, you know, you don't want it. If you really see it, you say, wow, this is something I can really do without. And you'll be less prone to chasing after the madness. No matter how beautiful it might seem superficially. You might say, no. I don't want to chase after that. And knowing you cannot impose knowing on belief. It's impossible. Only by disavowing belief can we grab it, you know, go back towards to knowing. Can't have both. Cannot have both. Knowing doesn't have any belief in it. And belief doesn't have any knowing in it. And the two will never meet. Will never meet. Will never integrate. Belief has this ridiculous notion of integration. Or calls it diversity. You know, it hides it behind diversity. That there's unity and diversity. In other words, that if we just somehow integrate, you know, knowing and belief, then we'll have some kind of superior situation, say, you know, where the complaints of both belief and knowing are both addressed and both solved with this integration. Certainty doesn't have any, certainty does not have any complaints. It's only belief that has the complaints. Certainty doesn't know, it knows that it is invulnerable. It's not threatened. It's not threatened by belief. There's no complaints. Doesn't have any need to have complaints addressed. His belief is the one with all the complaints. His belief's the one that's saying that, how is that, what's going on there? So, and you cannot integrate knowing and belief. Completely impossible. Wherever there is knowing, belief is absent. Wherever there is belief, knowing is absent. And so, seeing all of this is helping set up a situation where when belief is fleeing, that you don't get it backwards and think that it is fleeing because you're some wicked person and you're trying to harm belief and threaten belief, and that you need to, the way to reassure them is to disavow your certainty, your love of certainty. Yeah, that is the real danger. Again, only our attraction to belief, only our attraction to certainty can be threatened. Certainty itself cannot be threatened. But our attraction absolutely can be threatened. Really, it really can be severely threatened. And it is being threatened, severely threatened right now. Severely threatened. And, you know, even the best teachings in this world are being used now to justify belief and the agenda of belief, and to attract you to belief and try to get you to disavow your love of certainty. They're even being spun and used that way. So even if the fleeing takes even the holy books with them and takes the gurus with them and all this stuff, you still have to let it go. Let it go, let it go, let it go. Because it's only their spin, it's only their belief that they're taking, really. For instance, A Course in Miracles. Very, very clear teaching that helps us gravitate towards our love of certainty. It has been spun in various ways to actually make it seem like it's supporting what belief is doing, supporting the reestablishment of belief, you know, the matriarchy, the goddess worship, all this kind of stuff. Like it's supporting all that. Like it's supporting the agenda, the religion of belief. It's been spun as if it's supportive of that, which is absolute nonsense. But it can seem like, you know, oh, you know, that is fleeing too. That teaching is fleeing from me also. Not true. Certainty never flees from certainty. The love of certainty never flees from the love of certainty. Reality doesn't flee from itself. It's only belief that flees from it. And the interpretations of belief will flee from certainty. And those interpretations, I mean, for instance, like Anandamayama, many, many people have had all sorts of beliefs about Anandamayama. And, you know, and looking at them, I just say, what are they talking about? And that's just, it's got it backwards. You know, they think that she came here to help establish the return of the matriarchy and feminism and all of that, and help belief reestablish itself. I mean, that's what a lot of the belief about her is, which is completely backwards. Totally insane. Exactly opposite. Came here to help free us from that, free us to make sure our attraction to certainty is strong enough that we do not get attracted back to the religion of belief. And yet most people in the world believe that the opposite of that, which is, you know, just so you have to realize when belief flees, it will carry its icons and its idols with it, and it will make an idol out of all these ambassadors of reality and these holy books and holy teachings, and makes idols out of them, and will take those idols with them. And you have to, you know, don't try to go salvage these idols from them. You know, don't try to say, I got to pursue them because they're you know, taking Anandamayama with them. They're taking their belief with them. They're not taking the certainty that was appeared as Anandamayama. They're not taking that with them at all. So you just have to continue to abide in the certainty. Don't go chasing after them. Don't go chasing after they're taking their interpretation of A Course in Miracles with them. It's their interpretation. It's the interpretation of belief. The certainty, which A Course in Miracles pointed to, is that certainty. They're not taking that certainty with them. That certainty remains exactly where it is. And so just abide, remain with that certainty. So this is the satsang I'm giving now. So it's different. It's different than the other satsangs, you know. It really is. And this is what I see. It's very pragmatic. It's talking about what the real dangers are. Those who have chosen a new idea have no danger or threat to them whatsoever. But do not pretend that you're one of those if you haven't done it. If you haven't done that, then definitely your attraction to certainty can be undermined. And we're in a situation now where the danger of being undermined is absolutely severe. Extremely severe. And therefore, we need to recognize that the trap, as this fleeing of belief flees from certainty, don't go in pursuit. Do not go in pursuit. Don't say, oh, they're kicking the needle of my favorite with them, and I must go tell them that this is not right, or I must make, you know, correct their misinterpretations about this teacher, you know. No. The teachers know that teachers of certainty know that belief makes an idol of them and then flees with these idols. They know that. It doesn't bother them. It doesn't bother certainty. That's just what belief does. And then belief will hold up these idols and say, this great teacher insisted that we need to establish this religion, and that's the true religion. And then people will bow, you know, and say, oh, yes, okay. And, you know, you have to put up with that. Don't go thinking that you need to be a hero, you know, a knight gallant, and go protect the teacher from the barbarians, you know, as they carry an idol of the teacher or an idol of the teaching. Of course, that's what belief does. Of course, that's what it does. And you have to just, you know, let them flee. They will eventually, you know, a new ambassador of certainty will sometime come to them. Just a different suit of monkey suit, a flesh suit, meat suit will appear. And they'll track them to certainty. You know, it's not the meat suit that's important, it's the certainty that's important. When you look at Raman Maharshi and Anandamayi, Jesus Christ or Buddha or any of the others, what you're looking at is certainty. What you're feeling is certainty. It's not the meat suit. Meat suit doesn't matter. It's not important. It's the certainty. So it's just certainty with a meat suit, holding up a meat suit in front of it so people can kind of relate, you know, to it better. And certainty can hold up, you know, another meat suit, different cycles, different times and places, different situations too. But keep this attraction to certainty. Keep reminding, hey, your true love is certainty. That's all they do. They say, hey, you realize, oh, my true love is certainty. And so you feel, oh, it's a reminder. You get so enmeshed in belief in this world and the false love of flesh that you forget your love of certainty. But when you see an ambassador of certainty, suddenly you feel something within. You say, oh, what is that? It's just love. Love of what? Love of certainty. Because that is what the ambassador of certainty is, just a meat suit in front of certainty, window dressing in front of certainty. Certainty appearing to be carrying a meat suit around. But the certainty is there, and you feel the certainty, and you say, oh, that's what I really love. And then that starts the gravitation towards certainty. And so in different time, different place, different cycles, you know, certainty will carry around a meat suit again of some type. Doesn't matter what the meat suit is at all. Doesn't matter what the name is, the meat suit, etc. It is just certainty itself. It is certainty itself. Which is reality is certainty. And we love certainty. It's ineradicable. We cannot eradicate it at all. It's intrinsic. That's our home. That's what we are created for. As we are certainty. That is what we are. We are certainty itself. We can never, ever get rid of that love for certainty. But we can make attempts to get rid of it, and those attempts to get rid of it are very nasty, very regretful. So let us take heed during these times, again, to listen to this and at least get a sense. You don't want to pursue belief as it flees and carries all its idols, you know, and you follow these false idols, interpretations, twisted, distorted, upside down, backwards interpretations, my gosh. As Jesus said in the Course in Miracles, that so many, many bitter idols have been made of Jesus. You know, he's just stating it as a fact. You know, he says, wow, amazing number of false idols have been made of my teaching, of what I was here for, etc. Yeah, and that will happen to any teacher. Any appearance of certainty, world belief will oppose it and twist it and distort it and try to twist it so it actually leads away from our love of certainty. That's just what happens here. Don't go chasing after those idols. Don't try to be a protector of the idols. Don't try to be a hero. Let belief flee. And it will leave you with, you know, wow, everything will become so beautiful, beautiful, more and more beautiful. Because they're going to take all their, you know, cruddy baggages of death with them, and sickness and torture and torment and all the stuff. All their baggage. Let them go. another cycle, they'll be approached again by certainty. All right. Very great. We did another one. It gets better and better and better and better and better. More and more to the point. And you won't hear this type of satsang in many other places in this world, I can tell you that. So I'm glad to be able to share this with you. Of course, I feel threatened in doing so. You know, potentially, absolutely. But also I feel that there will be this fleeing, you know, and everything will be okay. All right, that's it for this video.